This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. As creatives and artists, we have each personally experienced the turbulent road of artistic self-improvement. And as the co-founder of the LA-based artist collective, No Wave and No Wave Academy, I can tell you that our objective is to offer an alternative path to a traditional arts education. No Wave Academy courses are taught by some of our favorite artists. They're also our personal heroes and colleagues. Some of these artists you may have heard on this very podcast, while others have been featured in exhibitions at the No Wave Gallery. Such artists include Casey Baugh, Mia Bergeron, Nick Runge, Sean Cheatham, and Kate Zambrano, to name a few. All of our instructors are working professional artists that have been showcased in galleries and museums, both locally and around the world. At No Wave Academy, we work tirelessly towards evolving the way you learn and to expand your artistic passion and craft from the very best in the field. We believe that everyone has a unique artistic spirit. With guidance, experience, and the proper tools, students have the ability to invigorate and elevate their work. You can unlock and unblock your creative inner voice. Join us and walk into the next chapter of your personal artistic evolution. Go to nowaveacademy.com, that's nohwaveacademy.com, type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. Now, on to the episode. Hey everyone, hope you're having a beautiful and wonderful day. This is your host, Yoshino, and thank you for tuning in to Artist Decoded. We're now on episode 181, and my guest today is English artist and painter, Justin Mortimer. Justin jump-started his career at the ripe age of 21 by winning first place at the BP Portrait Award, which is held at the National Portrait Gallery in London, and is considered to be one of the most prestigious competitions in the world of contemporary art. He's also painted portraits of people such as Queen Elizabeth II, David Bowie, and Harold Pinter, to name a few. We had a highly engaged conversation talking about various authors he likes, including J.G. Ballard. We also talk about his feeling of being an outsider during the time period of the YBA artist movement, which includes artists such as Tracy Emin, Damien Hirst, and Jenny Saville, to name a few. We also touched on the idea of finding inspiration, which is more so about finding the nuance in simple everyday things. As Justin would describe, finding some scratches found on a truck, the placement and inquiry of these scratches, and the purpose of them. I just love the way that Justin's mind works, so it was fun for me to riff with him about various ideas related to the human condition in relation to artistic and creative practices. But currently, Mortimer has a solo show exhibiting at Gwacheon, South Korea at Space K entitled Tomorrow, which continues until the 6th of November. So you should check that out if you're in South Korea currently at the moment. Also, another exciting announcement, but we recently launched our Patreon page. You can gain first access to uncut episodes before they're live, exclusive Artist Decoded video content, and an Ask Me Anything section so I can answer whatever questions you may have related to or not related to the artistic process. Just ask me whatever you'd like. I'm super excited to be able to provide this for AD listeners. Go to patreon.com/artistdecoded to find out more. And if you can't support that way, go to our iTunes page, leave us a review so viewers just like yourself can find out about this podcast, and the more the merrier. So here it is, my conversation with artist and painter Justin Mortimer. Hope you enjoy it. So yeah, thanks for joining me today again, and yeah, I really appreciate you and your time, and yeah, very much respect you and your work. And so there's something that I wanted to ask, and this is in regard to J.G. Ballard.
And right.
So you mentioned him on the Zoom call that we had yesterday, and I was watching this interview on the BBC with him, and the interviewer and him were talking about the end of one world creates another one, and welcoming the idea of things breaking down, and how J.G. Ballard's work is surrounded somewhat around that idea. And then he was saying, I think they were talking about like his curiosity towards what, you know, he would deem as disaster fiction, quote unquote.
Okay.
And Ballard said, in order to re-mythologize yourself and in order to recharge one's imaginative batteries and to discover some hidden truth about yourself, all central characters have to behave in a paradoxical way and embrace the cataclysm because they're trying to embrace some psychological truth about themselves.
Okay.
And I bring this up because our conversation the other day, it seemed as if you're going through this sort of transformational process right now, this gestation process when we were talking about death and rebirth. And this quote from him stood out to me. And I also just think about that in the creative process, about how we're all trying to try to find out some psychological truth about ourselves. And I was curious what you thought about that.
Well, that's quite a thing to think about. I think it's something that one does unconsciously. I know he talks about his experiences in Lungwa camp as a young boy and being surrounded by all these adults that were all freaking out, and he saw the collapse of this sort of British Empire civilization, this thin civilization was all broken down, and he really bonded with these Americans that he thought were much more full of life and things. But anyway, I drift from the point. But what I really liked was the way that he felt very separate right from the start, being this young kid in this camp, this internment. And he's always been a writer that deals with that separate other part of society, which I think comes from those experiences. And I think, I don't know, maybe I'm not being very clear about it, thinking aloud here, but I've always been very attracted to it because I've always felt very separate and a bit of an outsider as well, especially from my own childhood experiences. And I've been attracted to writers who express some kind of otherness about what it is to be human. And I think being a figurative painter, I can't but help try to explore that and find something that's beyond the prosaic, and to find the fantastic within the prosaic of talk as well, in the way that, say, Ballard talks about swimming pools or high-rise flats or the aluminium trim in a 1960s car or something. The way these normal everyday things become fetishized and have some other kind of resonance, like some kind of totem, some kind of voodoo is brought to these everyday things, just as when one paints a person, some kind of magic is released. That sounds quite fanciful, but I do believe there's something more going on making work like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that you speak about feeling like an outsider, and
sure.
Yeah, I'm curious. Well, first of all, I'm curious why you say that, and you know, I feel like that outsider thing that you think about. I mean, you've spoken about that in terms of how the young British art movement was happening adjacent to when you were coming up, you know, with Jenny Saville and Tracy Emin and Damien Hirst, for instance, and how you felt like an outsider during that time period.
But it also goes much, much deeper, but dealing with the art school situation in late 80s, early 90s London, there was such a big scene going on. And a painter such as myself, we did have places we could exhibit, such as the National Portrait Gallery with various competitions they ran annually and things like that. But the whole art world was embracing this big, big movement, which needed to happen, which was great. But on a personal level, it's quite difficult to find a place where you could slot in or feel you could fit. And I think for a long time, I fought that. And it's taken me years to actually come to the conclusion that being an outsider and being an oddball is actually rather fantastic and a great place to be. And talking about Ballard's early experiences in Lungwa camp, I mean, I came from a a family, quite an itinerant family. My father was in the Navy and we moved around a lot, and meant that friendships were fragmented. I was sent to boarding school at 11, which I found a massive shock, a hugely cruel infliction on a young child, really. And I found that a very hard journey to navigate. And it was through my art and through my art teacher there that I survived it, really, and found a sense of myself through making pictures, which at the time was a very, very natural process for me. I mean, I'd also spent a lot of time in hospital as a child as well for various reasons. And I'd seen around me, just like Ballard saw his parents bickering with other English families in this sad camp, this desperate situation, and the sort of breakdown of society. And from a very, very early age, I was very, very aware, say about the age of 3, 4, 5, through those early years of me as an outpatient in a child's hospital, and seeing how a human body can be so fractured and dismembered and broken, even sitting in the outpatient's department, watching parents. I mean, I actually wasn't in such a bad state. I just had to have some surgery done on my legs, but I was witnessing, which also, of course, through crash and the whole fetishization of calipers and things that we all know about, that I could not, the lexicon of fractured limbs and carapaces holding bodies together. I mean, I witnessed these things for myself, seeing children with exoskeletons holding their bodies together and mothers reading out football results to their blind children or whatever. These things went in very, very deep to me. I mean, at the time, it was normal operating procedure for me. I was used to it. But thinking back to those days now, especially those experiences compressed even more and consolidated with this alienating experience of boarding school and the brutality that is inherent in that system. I can really see now why I make work that I do. It's quite obvious. So this great figurative drive, this work I was making, did not fit at all in contemporary art scene of late 20th century London, particularly. Mm-hmm. And it's taken me a while to find out and communicate with artists all around the globe. So at the time in London, I was in this kind of tiny monoculture of art school. We fed off each other, of course, but now that I'm able to talk to artists around the world, you suddenly find you are kind of part of a scene. But I've always remained that English guy who does those paintings, and I'm embracing that now, embracing the outsideness, you know. I'm happy about that.
Mm. So I know you've talked about that in some interviews before about, you know, feeling constricted, and you even likened the...
Oh, really?
Well, you were talking about that, you know, when you're a child and, you know, having braces on your legs, for instance, and you were pointing towards a painting that you were saying, oh, you know, I had something similar, and I understand that feeling because that was actually me. And then you were talking about constriction in terms of plastics and utilizing things such as balloons in your paintings. And
that's so right.
And so it's interesting
I interrupted. Yeah, it's a proxy for the body. I always found that the membrane of the... Anyway, carry on. I was interrupted you there.
Oh, no. You said, no. Just, what were you saying? Like, it's a proxy?
Yeah, I always felt there was some visceral quality about balloons. The way people fetishize latex and fashion, things like that. I always felt there were proxies for the human body. And having a body that is, personally, that is some slightly anomalous to the ideal form, you're aware of yourself, maybe a way that, or you're aware of other people's bodies, I should say. I mean, I'm perfectly happy with my body, but I think I'm hyper aware of how other people fit in their skin, physically and mentally. And as an observer, that really feeds into the work. So I'm always looking for the quirky, anomalous thing that is very beautiful or strange. I mean, that partly also comes from a very highly tuned eye from spending years as a professional portrait painter, of course. You know? So I've honed those skills as well. But this kind of voyeuristic thing and fascination artists have, figurative artists have as well with the body, is something that's just always been there, I think. I mean, I was always drawing since I was a child. I think this art teacher I had at school started taking me to life classes at the age of 11, which is extraordinary.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah, yeah. So suddenly from making up my own figures, which were basically me copying comic books and history paintings from history books my dad had at home, like great big battlefield scenes. Why is it all us boys were always drawing great big battle scenes? And I was exactly the same, you know, I'd do a whole D-Day landing. I thought it was like the Bayeux tapestry in my bedroom, but think about it now, it's four pieces of foolscap taped together and stuck on my wall. At the time, I thought I'd done Omaha Beach or Sword Beach or whatever, these tiny little figures. And as I got better at drawing, I was immersed in this whole fantasy world. It was so powerful, and it was just a great place to be. Mm. And my art teachers, at the age of 11, started showing me how I could draw from life. And in some ways, I kind of regret the fact that I suddenly went from being this boy who could make dreams alive and feel the power in that to suddenly be faced with, I mean, I remember the name of my first life model. He was called Wally, and it was in the Adult Education Centre in Somerset, in the town I was at school. And, he was absolutely ripped. He was as buff as they come. He was a professional diver, I think, and without any clothes on. I was trying to find where to hang the line off him. Of course, I now know that there's lots of these edges and shapes and so tall body, but I remember the time being totally covered. Where to start drawing him? Yeah. Funny.
Interesting. Yeah. Yeah. And I think, it's really interesting, like, as we get older and as professional working artists, depending on what your focus is, but, you know, I think just something that comes to mind is the idea of latex and how latex is something that it almost transforms someone, although it constricts you physically.
Yeah.
But it says something about the internal way that you process things. And maybe it, you know, if you were to wear like a gimp outfit or something and, you know, it expresses an internal monologue in a way. And it allows for freedom while there is also constriction. But then I also think about that in terms of, you know, the fashion that we're talking about, but also like, you know, observations of body modifications and body dysmorphia. And
it's all endlessly fascinating. I mean, I started painting latex in about, I don't know, late 90s. Early 90s, in fact. I started painting bin liners. So in the studio, I was still painting all of these still lives from life. In the corner of my studio, I had this big bin liner just full of all the crap from the studio.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, all the crap, all the old paint and newspaper in this bag. And I thought, look at the way this internal pressure is actually shaping the outside of this thin plastic surface and the beauty of that. And also the way it told a story about what's happening inside. So then I thought, how do I apply that to figures? And of course, there's the whole sort of latex fashion thing. And I tried to make some pictures about that. But I just came up against the wall because all the images I was trying to collect were all highly sexualized. And that wasn't the scene I was into at all. But I was fascinated in the way that it did describe the inner form. So like you mentioned, the pressure of muscles and bone pushing against this membrane. Mm-hmm. Just as it does to real skin, but somehow it is slightly accentuated and becomes something else. And there's also immaculate as well. It's the whole shiny thing, which is a word I think that scene uses as well. I did a few works like that, which I don't think were that successful. But in a way, I knew I was onto something. Mask, you mentioned the gimp mask thing. And then the way that is a politicized image now, taken up by feminist movements such as Femin and Pussy Riot and things like that, and you also see it. You know, and it's also the lexicography of terrorism and all that kind of thing. And here we are now, in the middle of all this COVID business, and we're all wearing masks. I've just taken my mask off myself and stood on the tube. We're all wrapped, covered now. And that is endlessly fascinating to me. And I also, it plays into my kind of a slightly perverse rejection of being a portrait painter. I always thought painting a portrait was beyond just dealing with the physiognomy of a face. And a mask hides that, but also it heightens it somehow. I want to discover more about the person inside it.
So then how has portrait painting transformed for you over the course of time?
Well, I mean, it got to the point where I was, maybe about 10 years ago, where I was able not to have to do it to live. You know, I left college, big prize here in England. Well, maybe it's an international competition, I'm not sure, but it's the BP Portrait Award, age of 21. And that gives you, it wasn't something I was planning on doing, but because I'd won this portrait competition, having done a painting with three friends of mine at college, I was given a commission for their permanent collection, which is absolutely extraordinary. And I got to paint and to know very well. Yeah, so by default, I became a kind of a portrait painter. Mm-hmm. And because I had a picture on the wall in this gallery, my name on it, people would contact me, and I was able to paint these pictures for money, which paid the studio rent and was at home and everything like that. And it just carried on like that for years. But of course, I had stories inside me kind of welling up somewhat, and I needed to express them. It felt like a novel I had to write or something, but it had to be in pictures. So I had to slightly navigate away from the portrait world, which I found quite closed, fascinating. And I made some great friends I still have from that world, but I knew there was more in me, you know, I wanted to go further. So by having a few reasonably successful shows back in the day, I was able to say no to missions and spend more time doing more investigative work with my painting, my own stories, you know, going back to be that kid doing those drawings I was talking about before I started training to be an artist, in inverted commas, which in some ways is quite destructive.
Destructive in what way?
Well, you get all this knowledge, don't you? You think you're getting all this knowledge. From the age of 11 going to the life class, as fascinating as it was, my eyes opened to this whole. But suddenly there's this baggage of you have to now make art. And one always looks back to that time when I was just making art for itself. And that's also kind of a lot of art that I like to look at, art that's just made for itself, not trying to be packaged as art. This is an object. This is a painting. I respond to stuff that is art by accident. I remember as a boy I knew it was like a superpower growing in me. It was quite extraordinary, just drawing cars or inventing sports games or battlefield scenes. And then I started, my first references, I think, were being really bored at school on a sort of a wet Sunday afternoon, sort of no man's land between homework and running around the football, sort of. Watching TV footage of, say, downhill skiers I remember the other day I started to watch, I used to draw from the television. These are moving images of ice hockey players. We don't have ice hockey here, right? But seeing the goal, the guys in the goals with all this accoutrement, this armor, strange. I remember drawing that and just being fascinated by that. So, and this all went as soon as I started going to a life class. I suddenly thought, I've now got to train to be an artist, like a musician. You know, you have to learn all these kind of ways of finessing your skills. And as much as I enjoyed the power growing in me, I could feel myself getting better and better. Then I plateaued out very, very, I plateaued about 16. I hit a kind of a wall. And it took many, many years of getting out of that. And I don't think I really climbed out of that until I was probably just about the time I left art school. Yeah, and then having a studio, and I could work on my own ideas, and then it started to grow again in little increments.
Yeah, I mean, even what we were talking about in the beginning about, you know, the death and rebirth thing and being able to reinvent yourself and also reinvent the way that you think about things. And so I'm curious, like, at what point did the collaging work come into play? And then also, you know, you were talking about in like a different interview about you would take these photojournalistic images, but you wouldn't use the foreground element, you know, the thing that most people would focus on, but you would use the less obvious thing in the background.
But
I think about that and within that context, and it, you know, I think the more observant that you are of just your surroundings and intaking, you know, like how we were talking about Ballard earlier about these little observations, you know, and
yes,
that very that true. Photo, in a way, the thing that is on the outside, it almost speaks to this idea of the way that you have viewed yourself as being like an outsider and being observant of the things that are maybe people wouldn't notice, you know.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, but my other half, she always finds it hilarious how I'm always noticing stuff that no one else would really give a damn about. Or I have this weird thing of recognizing people a year later, someone I stood next to in a queue in another country. I'll see them somewhere else, and it's them. It's really odd. It's really odd. I mean, that I don't know whether that's just part from training my eye, just drawing and painting all the time, or whether it was just there in the first place. And therefore, I became an artist because of that innate thing that was always there, some heightened thing. I mean, I'm rubbish at a lot of things, but I'm pretty good at observing, that's for sure. And so to answer your question about the collaging, I mean, that kind of came about as a simple means to answering a problem which I had, which I just found I wanted references that were outside of what I was surrounded by. And I first used collages well before any digital technology was around. I mean, I had this dream that maybe there's a computer program one day that I'll be able to use to so I could use collaging digitally. And of course, we now use Photoshop, but back in the early 90s, when that was still a dream, I was cutting up mail order catalogs, magazines, things like that, or taking Polaroids, lots and lots of Polaroids, and cutting them up, 35 mil shots, and cutting those up and literally gluing them together and drawing from them and painting from them. And then as Photoshop started to emerge, I played around on that very crudely. I mean, I'm hopeless, really. Mm-hmm. But I found it's very, very powerful. It draws you in. And I talk to students, and it's all, want to be careful how you use it, you know. You have to be pretty careful. Otherwise, it's too easy, you know. You end up with a generic look. You've got to be really careful on that front. But it's so fantastically powerful. And a lot of artists use it now very, very usefully. And I find it just very simple things. For instance, you know, I used to paint a hand. So I'd paint my own hand. Or I'd paint my other hand. So I'd put it in the mirror, paint my hand that way. Now, you just flip it on the computer. It's very easy at creating a map. I use the collages now as kind of a map, a plan for what I'm going to do, because what happens on the paintings later is chaos. It's carnage compared to this very cool laid out print that I make from Photoshop. And I make lots of prints, as I'm sure you know, as the painting progresses. And I photograph the painting as it goes along. Anyway, I digress, but that's kind of how it works. Yeah. Mm. But I think that idea you're talking about with the fragments and finding those lost corners is something I'm always interested in. I mean, it's never the obvious thing. It's never the subject. It's never the mother load I'm interested in. It's always the sideways. It's always the askance. It's always the glint corner out of the corner of your eye. Mm-hmm. It's that tiny under thing. And it's the same with look at painting, or, you know, I'm always looking where you shouldn't be. And I do that with my own work, whether that means, you know, there's games all artists do. We look at our paintings through blackened mirrors, or we stand upside down, or God knows what. You know, we do all these things to kind of trick yourself into seeing something new. And it's often the first thing I notice as I walk into the studio. I look at a painting I was working on for 8 hours a day before, and I know straight away what's wrong with it. Whereas yesterday I was actually kicking back and being rather smugly self, you know, rather pleased with myself with that bit. And I walk in 12 hours later and think, that is such a pile of rubbish. That's got to go. Yeah, but then that's the clarity, isn't it? The clarity, fresh eye. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah, it's interesting how, like, painting and you're constantly learning and constantly trying to reimagine what you would want to paint on that canvas, or, you know, taking something completely out. And I always think about just how you're constantly learning even until those final moments. I mean, we were talking about your show up in Korea right now, tomorrow, and how, you know, you're talking about how you can see now what else you would want to paint within that, you know, or what you would want to take out. And I always think about that, even like, you know, talking right now, you know, it's, we're kind of riffing off each other, and there we're constantly through these fragmented thoughts coming up with something that turns into a conversation, right? And you have your experiences, I have my experiences, and then I think about that also in the way that we view art. You know, it's, you have your intention about what you want to convey on that canvas, and then me as the viewer, I come in and then I bring my own baggage and my own projections on onto that piece as well.
I love that. Yeah. I love the fact that my intentions are awfully totally askance to whatever narrative, whatever baggage the viewer is bringing. I mean, that's partly what makes work have a long life, really. If you're spoon feeding the viewer, it's dull. I mean, it's like watching a film. If you know what's going to happen next, you're not interested. So if there's some kind of puzzle, some kind of mystery set up, some capacity in the narrative, whatever, like, if there's that mystery, the viewer's going to be engaged. One hopes. I mean, it might be some dreadful painting. Maybe there won't be. But when you get it right, it's very, very powerful. And also, this whole thing about learning until, you know, never knowing when the picture's going to finish. I never know when a work's really, really finished. I think I only really know when I've actually either destroyed it, sold it, or put it away for 5 years and see it again, or see it again 5 years' time in a book or a catalog and think, okay, yeah, there's a full stop there. That's okay. I can cope with that. Hmm. And I often wonder how can writers kind of commit to publishing that novel when they ever want to sort of to go back and redact and change and edit? And it's the same with my paintings, really. It's when you've done them, you're never quite sure. But certainly when you're making them, I'm rarely sure. But that's the fun, because the paint does its own thing, and this whole mysterious thing kicks in when your mind and you're operating on some other lower functioning part of you, some real animal part of your mind that's doing something that your more banal upper level possibly know. Unfortunately, it's very hard to get the two to connect. But when you're in the zone, you know, as we all know, it's a great thing. I'm meandering here, but I suppose not knowing is great is the answer.
I like to hear your meanders. I think it opens up for very interesting conversation. And but I also think about, you know we're talking about just not knowing when something is finished, and also the constant observational qualities and curiosity. But then I also think about the opposite side of the coin, when people want to view things in a way that's almost spoon-fed to them. They want the answer. They want the obvious thing. And I mean, I think, you know, the older that I get, the more that I recognize, like, through to develop empathy, as well as just trying to understand, okay, well, this person sees things totally different than I do, you know, and I mean, we could even talk about that in a social way or a political way. There's so many different types of thoughts and trains of thoughts and perspectives of this world. And, you know, I guess it goes back to that psychological thing, like trying to find some sort of psychological truth within ourselves is, you know, trying to also find the psychological truth in other people. So,
it's very tricky. It's very hard. I mean, politically, trying to find empathy with people diametrically opposed to yourself, now that we're going down this partisan path, it is very difficult. And views are becoming more and more entrenched. I feel it in myself. I'm fed up with feeling angry and bitter and annoyed about people, whether it be, you know, alt-right or QAnon or Brexit here in the UK. All this stuff, it's pernicious and devastating, very hard, and it's hard to keep focused on the things that are important, whether it be your loved ones or what you do from day to day. It's hard. It's very, very hard. I don't know. Yeah. I think we have to really strive to find something of empathy, and some people do it through just feelings. Something to do it through, I suppose.
Mm. Yeah.
Just talking to someone, you know, without getting punched in the face, but it's getting more and more difficult. But maybe I'm just seeing it from a very small lens. Through a much broader perspective. We're just operating as normal as humans. It's just same old, you know. Mm-hmm. I think it's just when it affects us on a personal level, it's very hard to see the bigger picture. Mm. I'm no philosopher, but I think we're all suffering a bit at the moment, aren't we?
No, yeah, I agree. And I think some people have more of a sensitive propensity towards understanding that, and others would like to bury it within their subconscious, you know, and not be aware of it and just carry on with a myopic perspective of positivity.
Yeah, I mean, and also not really caring and not knowing. I mean, certainly the old cliche, ignorance is bliss, in a way it is rather fantastic. I mean, certainly. Now, I remember when all that ISIS stuff was going on a few years back and beheadings and all that kind of carnage was going on, and just talk to people. People just couldn't bear to listen to the news at the time and would elect to not listen to the radio or just any media interaction was just stopped. And that, as a survival ploy or instinct, it was kind of successful. But if you're curious enough to even own a radio, it's going to seep back into you. But, you know, now we're in another situation, but from the long view, you know, we're not in a world war situation at the moment. I was born into a comfortable society. I wasn't born in a war zone. You know, things are good, really, in some respects. It's perspective is all, I suppose.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, even just being able to have this conversation about, you know, the way the world works and our, you know, perspectives on art. I mean, that is just such a privileged point of view to be able to even talk about these things in a way that we're trying to intellectualize them and understand it. But I mean, you know, speaking of certain visceral qualities and
I was just thinking that myself. Yeah, go on.
Interesting. Yeah. Well, I was going to draw it back to just, you know, your show tomorrow. And I know a lot of the paintings. Well, I mean, first there's a certain attraction to hazmat suits that you've had for a while. So I want to somewhat talk about that. But also how I believe that some of those pieces were you painted during the Ebola crisis, right? And how those ideas have transformed, you know, going through what we've been going through with COVID-19 and how they've given new meaning now.
Yeah, it's strange. I mean, I've always had quite a dark view in some respects. I mean, a lot of people who know me think I'm quite a funny, easygoing guy. But, you know, other people would tell you that I'm actually I've got that darkness, which is, I suppose, is inherent in a lot of people who make art and whatever medium. And I always thought, well, I decided about maybe 10 years ago, I'd want to make some paintings about something that really, really upsets me and frightens me. Mm. I want to make paintings about the thing that is worrying. So I started thinking about, it's the sound of jackboots walking down your street. It's social cleansing. I mean, this was in the context of me in the studio cleaning my brushes on a big stack of newspapers. And I got to the bottom of this stack of newspapers and I'd gone through a few years worth of newspapers and I found myself cleaning my brushes on top of photographs that had come from the Balkan Wars. Balkan War, you know. And and seeing that really had a big effect on me. We as a late 20th century kind of guy, I was brought up on war films and war comics, as all the image wars were all about World War II, Korea, Vietnam. It was wars were about jungles and faraway places. It was so to see wars happening in Europe very close to where I was cleaning my brushes on that newspaper article really kind of pulled me up and made me have this sudden moment of empathy that we're talking about. I was looking at these people who were fearful because have they just been divided from their fathers and sons? Have they just been taken up to the hills and shot, all this kind of stuff? Absolutely horrific. And I couldn't but help respond to that. So I started to think about how I would feel like that. I would put myself in their position. Most people don't want to do that. You want to run a million miles from that. But I thought, what would I feel if an invading army, an army that speak your own language, were coming down your street to murder you because you were of a slightly different persuasion, whether it be religion or sexuality or whatever? So I started thinking about that and researching that a little bit. And painting, and paintings of genocide just seem to happen. Not in any particular historical perspective, the actual pictures, just paintings about very dark stuff. And it was the first show I did with that work. I think it was called In Your Own Village, and I showed it in a small gallery above a pub here in London. And incredibly, all the work sold, actually, even though it's pictures of total carnage. I mean, I was aware of, you know, Goya's work, all that, and people have dealt with that kind of imagery. It was the first time I started to delve into that. And so, of course, you go from, you know, naturally you go from genocide to plague, you know, of course. Mm-hmm. So, you know, yeah, so I started looking at trying to exist in a poisoned world. So you have hazmat suits and protective suits, of course, ties in very clearly. There's that lineage from the PVC latex clothing, which we were talking about earlier, straight through to these highly coloured plastic exoskeletons and protective suits. And I found them fascinating on multiple levels. For the body's wrapped, so it's kind of explicit about the body that's underneath, the way a crease can describe the body underneath, which I'm interested in, but the way also it hides the body and it becomes this other being. And it was like a code for another form of humanity somehow. These codes, these suits became codes for something else, which I wanted to really explore. And so that became a series of work which keeps growing, really. Then all of a sudden, this body of work behind me, we are dealing with a plague here, for want of a better word. And the visual lexicon of hazmats and masks and covering and being separated from physical touch and all this is profound. And I don't know, as an artist who's made that kind of work, it's not about being prophetic at all, even though people have been joking about that. It's just about something that kind of scared me at the time, and now I'm having to deal with the reality of that.
Yeah, it's interesting how things have just changed so quickly too. You know, it seemed that there's this imminent doom. I mean, at least I can only speak for the perspective of being in the United States, but you know, there's this imminent doom that is occurring over in China, and then to be able to think that, you know, a month or a few months later, that doom would actually be on, I mean, you would be able to witness it, and it would completely change your reality, you know, the way that you live life. And so it becomes more real, and it also is something that pulls a lot of people together because they're all going through a similar thing at the same time.
And all the inherent cliches that come with that as well, this whole sort of pulling together, that whole bullshit of Dunkirk spirit they talk about here, which fed into a lot of the whole, all this rubbish that was talked about with the Brexit argument here and the whole partisan political landscape you have in America, all these cliches that go with that. You know, the whole make America great together, make America great again, all that, all this kind of stuff is meaningless, really. But I just through walking through London every day, I'm aware of past histories and experiences that have happened to people and people in my family or generations before us. It's just all there in the very fabric of the building. I mean, for instance, talking about cliches of social cohesion under duress, it's like the Blitz, people talk about here in the Blitz spirit. I mean, you can walk down the streets here, and I walk down the embankment weekend, and you can see great punctures of shrapnel still there in shops and buildings. I'm just passing down this street, you know, just quite happily. But 80 years ago or whatever, this was a devastation here. But society kept, you know, the world kept turning. People, this city maintained its cityness, shall we say, and it kept going. And people, there is optimism there. You know? And I think about, well, we all think about generations before us who went through some great struggles of First World War and the Second World War. Both sides of my grandparents, they all were involved in that. And my grandfather was wounded. My grandfather was on the beaches in France. And my grandmother was in RAF as well. You know, all this, we've all have those histories. And I think, how did they deal with that stress and anxiety? Maybe there wasn't so much. You know, our days are punctuated by media and imagery all the time. This whole, you know, we are flooded with it all the time. And maybe somehow back in the day, it was simpler. There was only one or two messages coming through. Okay, it was probably highly propagandized, of course. But it meant you contained some kind of focus. You could keep to that rail, you know. Whereas here, we're just scattergun. We don't know what to think anymore, do we? This pundit thinks that and someone else thinks this. It's just, oh, where do you find yourself in that?
Yeah, where do you find yourself in that shuffle almost?
Yeah,
totally. And then,
totally.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, something that comes to mind is just like this technological polarization that occurs when there's so much information being thrown at you at all times and not knowing exactly what's true or what to believe and how that...
Yeah.
But also, I mean, I don't know if you've seen this film yet, this documentary, The Social Dilemma. A lot of people are talking about it. Have you seen it yet?
No, I'm sorry, I haven't. No, I'm going to write that down.
The Social Dilemma. It's like on Netflix, but it just talks about... it just talks about how, you know, the generations are after us. So, you know, how essentially the people that grew up not always having a smartphone. And how it's affected them psychologically and how...
Interesting.
Yeah, and in a lot of like really negative ways, you know, even something as simple as like a face... Something as simple as like a face filter, for instance, and having that sort of social expectation to have tons of followers or, you know, those sort of things that people not necessarily pre-internet, I was going to say, but pre-smartphone, you know, where the accessibility to the world's information is at the tip of your fingers. You know, I feel like we could focus on things that are not... not all these insecurities of the world, right, are being put onto us. So I don't know, just something interesting that I think about.
It's devastating for the next generation, really. I mean, they're going to have to find their way to navigate through all that truth and untruth. I mean, truth is gone, isn't it, really? I mean, you know, I'm no expert, you know, but certainly, I mean, I'm very interested in AI and the possibilities of that and the benign possibilities of that. But I think when it starts to change people's psychology and its psychological state, that's going to be deeply worrying. We're going to have to evolve ourselves very deeply, and whether that means we're going to have some physical interaction with machines in the future, so be it. We're going to have, that's the way to survive in some respect. That's a possibility. I mean, I don't know, like being off in some sci-fi world now, but I think we're going to have to find some kind of way of living together, aren't we?
Yeah.
We already are, and we're finding it pretty damn difficult.
So I'm curious, like, you know, in terms of, you know, we were talking about just, you know, this time period for you having the show out and being able to figure out what you want to paint next.
I know
it's only been a day since we talked, but what sort of thoughts are going on in your brain right now?
I'm still having to collect images. At the moment, it was interesting hearing you talk to Phil Hale on a previous podcast of yours about how you were saying how, for him, his ideas don't necessarily come from the studio. And I think there's real truth there. I do a lot of walking in the countryside with my other half. I, you know, pack the bag, put some sandwiches in the backpack, drive out and do a 2-3 hour walk with the map or whatever. And it's just looking at nature and thinking, letting your brain goes somewhere else. That's where the ideas come. And also it's just coming across something that's really interesting on a walk can feed into an idea, which will then grow, and I might make a collage, or I might just make a note in a book, think about something. And that will become a place I can sort of journey down and build an idea from. I mean, for instance, like going on walks in the countryside are very important. Often you can come across, say, well, we're very lucky having all these incredibly old medieval churches here, and I find them so moving, not from a spiritual sense at all, but from the trace that is left by previous generations. And I find that absolutely extraordinary. So, for instance, medieval graffiti and marks left in their porches, or little cuts and marks, little witch marks or Gordian knots to wrap the devil in, things like this, just a scratch for the Virgin Mary, or a little line. I mean, there's churches in East Anglia that have medieval graffiti all about maybe the second plague that came through Europe. And just at that, and you're confronted by this graffito, and you're in exactly the spot that person, however many centuries ago, made that mark. Goes back to what we were saying earlier about dealing with all this stuff going on, situation we're in. And you are right back at the point that person was dealing with the death of his two children. His wife's got the plague. He's trying to work out what to do. He's not necessarily scratching a prayer to God, but he's doing something. He wants to have some kind of intervention to stop this horror that's around him. And yet this church still stands, and here I am, backpack full of salmons and a thermal fatigue, looking at this mark and judging and being moved. Yeah. You know, I'm looking at it from an aesthetic, but I'm also looking at it just from humanism there, you know. It's very, very moving. And from that, well, I suppose we can talk about it later, but art that I like to look at is often art like that graffito, or someone who lived in the caves 10,000 years ago and blew pigment over their hand, and there it is for us to discover. I find that deeply moving. And actually more interesting than most art that I love to be.
Yeah, you know what's interesting that comes to mind is when you're talking about that graffiti images, for instance, and the Cave of Forgotten Dreams. Have you seen that by Werner Herzog?
I know the one. No, I've only seen bits and pieces of it. Yeah, that needs to be seen. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but it just, that just, you know, comes to mind because, I mean, there's this cave that is thousands of years old in France, and you know, they're very well preserved, but I mean, it's really just thinking about, these archaeologists are just thinking about the stories that, you know, were trying to be conveyed, and how there's this bear on the wall, and how the artist, you know, created multiple figures to emulate a movement, you know, within the piece that was on the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it just, yeah, it's interesting how, like, because that person obviously is not around anymore. So we're kind of filling in the blanks as to the intention for the reason why they drew that thing on the wall. And, you know, even you going on this walk and finding it, I think he was at a castle, and, you know, and seeing those little...
The church.
And, you know, and also being able to fill in the blanks of those feelings and those emotions that were felt during that time period, if someone were to like lose their family or something like that. And yeah, I think what I've realized is interests in things, like the more that you dive deeper into the artistic practice, they don't become wider necessarily. They become more narrow and deeper, you know?
Oh, right. And nice,
so you can go down, walk down the street. And that's what I think about, you know, in terms of when people talk about, oh, what inspired you to do this? You know, and it's almost becomes this cliche, but inspiration literally comes from anywhere. You can get inspired by a leaf on the ground or a dead cat on the sidewalk.
Totally. You know? Yeah. Oh, no, that's it. That's what feeds me. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I at the moment, I'm going through a big period of looking at trucks on the street, just looking at the way the scratches have been formed and trying to decode. Why are those scratches there? Why is that skid truck got, it's because the chains have bashed across the side. And just thinking about how marks are made or the traces and the evidence that's there, I find that just the most boring, ugly stuff can be the most fascinating.
Like you said, Yeah. No, it's true. And I think, at least the artists that I admire, they either directly take things, occurrences that have happened to them, or they've witnessed within their own experiences and put it into their work as a direct thing. Someone that comes to mind is Ruben Östlin, who is the director of The Square. And he put certain things that he experienced in real life directly into the film. And I've heard T.S. Eliot does that as well, where he would have conversations with people. Just speaking about T.S. Eliot, for instance, I think for him, it was, you know, he comes from a very well-to-do family and is trying to understand how other people communicate, right? So to me, that's what it feels like from reading his work, for instance. But I just think about, just those observations and how powerful those observations are. And but something that comes to mind in your work, for instance, like me being the viewer of your work and looking at the collages and then thinking about the thing, for instance, maybe it's a balloon, right? And thinking about the thing that's behind that. And it almost becomes this dialogue of a subtextual context. And I think about that in terms of film as well, how it's not really about what they're saying, but it's about the thing that behind what they're trying to say. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. These codes we put up.
Yeah.
Yeah. For interpretive reasons. Yeah. Or not. You know, I think I'm interested in that mystery, as I've said. Yeah, it's not knowing the answers myself particularly. It's just an innate emotional response sometimes. I don't know all the reasons for why I put certain things into my work. Mm. It just somehow feels it has a resonance that fits. So the balloons was kind of a discovery. I mean, I was attracted to it the way light moves in it, and I thought it'd be a great carrier of color and would lend itself to have good abstract potential in a painting, just a physical shape of a brightly colored balloon or just the intellectual challenge of trying to render light reflecting off that surface. How the hell am I going to paint that? I didn't know I could paint balloons before I did the balloons. And I know the first painting I did with balloons, and I could see myself getting better at doing them, you know. And then, and in the first painting, I forget what name of it is, but they're very much balloons, and they're very much being dealt with in a balloony way. Mm-hmm. But they later become a cipher for something else, and that's probably where it becomes more interesting. Mm-hmm. Then they just became huge monster balloons, like something out of a nightmare. You know that?
Yeah. But I also like how that meaning transforms over time as well, because you know, you can constantly. I mean, let's say 10 years from now, you look back on some of those images that you created and it could have a completely different meaning.
It's interesting.
I just think about that in terms of film too. You know, there's films that I watched 10 years ago when I was in my early 20s, and now I watch the same film. And then I think about, okay, I understand why this film was written within the social context and why I, as a young person, like that film. But now I just think of it in totally different ways too. And
is that because you're more au fait with the kind of language of filmography and you know more about the directors and it's the knowledge thing? Are you trying to remember how you felt, just the visceral reaction to it as a younger person, and how that's changed? Now you can intellectualize it.
Yeah, I mean, but yeah, I think it's all of those things. But being able to also break down trains of thought so that you don't over intellectualize certain things as well, because I think there's, you know, sometimes people get caught into their own ego and pretentiousness instead of being able to enjoy something as well. So it's kind of a balancing act between all of that, you know. That's what I think, at least.
I suppose films I've always really enjoyed are the ones I remember enjoying as a child, just because it was so thrilling and frightening. And now to find films is often quite difficult, because we bring that kind of burden of expectation, and through having watched thousands of films over the past several decades, you know, I find it harder and harder. Yeah. The search for the child is always there, isn't it? child's reaction.
Yeah.
The child in all of us. It's, yeah.
Definitely. Oh, everything. Yeah.
The music we listen to is particularly difficult sometimes, I think. It's so nostalgic, isn't it? And, yeah. Gosh. Mm. Yeah.
Music has a lot of visceral qualities to it because you are able, I mean, assuming that it played a huge role.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, it just
music's much more interesting to me than painting, really. I mean, it really is. I'd much rather listen to music than look at someone else's painting. I'd rather listen to their album or listen to them just doing something crazy. Brick and a teacup and a stick, you know. Yeah. It's just there, isn't it? I mean, I remember a music teacher at school saying to me in front of a class, oh, well, because I was known as the artist in the class, and he just said, well, of course, music is much more interesting and emotional than art. Mm. I kind of went, well, sod you, mate. But now I kind of think, is there a truth there? It's terrible to say, but there's something the way it, maybe there are less firewalls in our heads. Music just drills down into maybe painting. What I like about painting is just a bit more of a slow burn.
Mm.
On the other hand, faced with, say, a de Kooning, that visceral quality is just there, and it punches you in the face, and I love that in painting too. Yeah, but for me, music is, it just feeds me all throughout the day. I mean, it's okay, sometimes I set moods a little bit. If I'm priming a canvas, Black Sabbath's pretty good, and if I'm painting something, it's going to be a bit more shoegazy, you know?
Yeah.
To express, really. But I've always seen I would describe painting and art in quite musical terms in some ways, I think. Yeah.
In what ways?
Yeah, you're going to ask me that. As soon as I said that. What am I putting out there, Mortimer? I can see the words coming out of my head in this pretentious bubble. And I thought, I've stymied myself there. Yeah, maybe we should move on.
I mean, speaking of music... I'm just curious, you know, your experiences, for instance, painting David Bowie.
And, oh, God, yeah, David.
Yeah, I'm curious, like, what you've learned, you know, from him, being able to spend time with him, and also just, you know, because you've painted, what was it, 8 or 9 portraits of him?
I ended up making 9 paintings, 3 of him and 6 of Iman. Yeah, I did. I did a few drawings from life as well. He couldn't be around for long. You know, he's a rock star. He's a busy guy, right? So yeah. I had to, this is a while back as well. So I took lots of Polaroids of them in my studio and in their various hotel suites. I'd go and have liaisons with, sort of creep in and ask for Mr. Smith or whatever it was, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very, very young, you know, and bowled over, of course, but he was... Charming, obviously. But he's a rock star, for crying out loud. So it's a bit nuts.
Yeah.
It's pretty nuts.
Totally.
Jeez. And I was just a little bit young for, you know, the whole Ziggy Stardust thing. I mean, let me think. I was probably 3 when he put Ziggy Stardust to bed, if not 2.
Oh, you know? Wow. Yeah.
So, like, talking to my uncle, I remember ringing him from a phone box in the corner of my street and said, Richard, you know, I've just painted. I mean, he couldn't believe it. It wasn't really my rock star. He wasn't the rock star for my generation. It was for generation maybe 15 years before me, I'd say. So yeah. I felt like a bit of a fraud, really. I shouldn't be the guy doing David. It should be someone maybe of that generation. But anyway, I had to deal with that. And I remember I did some drawings of him, and they were the worst, some of the worst drawings I've ever done. Some respect.
Why do you do that?
Well, just a terrible piece of work, but as a document of my experience being there with him and being all sweaty and kind of hyperventilating, it's kind of great, you know. Yeah. It's kind of good.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's awesome.
But no, we could bond in lots of ways. I mean, in those days I used to smoke, so, you know, we'd share Marlboro Reds together, and he'd pick up an art magazine in my studio, and we'd start talking about post-war British painting, which he was really into. So we'd talk about Kitaj, or we'd talk about Bomberg, and all these. That was fantastic. So, yeah, that was part of the kind of school where I came from as well, the whole London School of Painting, and we could really engage with that. And I'll tell you what, he once turned up at my studio and he thrust this cassette into my hand of some of his new work he was trying out, and I swear to God, that tape is in my attic somewhere, and I don't know where it is. I've got to find it because it must be its most. Can you imagine?
Oh my God! Wow, amazing. So.
Yeah,
so it's like some of his demos during that time period.
Yeah, but it might have been when he was just starting to get into drum and bass, so maybe it's not his good stuff, you know what I mean? So,
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
But he was great.
But it's also just interesting to see the trajectory of different prolific artists' work over time, too, and how it transforms. I mean, even, you know, you were talking about drum and bass, and I think drum and bass and David Bowie and I don't know. It's interesting to be able to listen to certain instinctual qualities within yourself and to be able to put that out there. And I mean, I like to see I like to see that within, like, you know, I guess very well-known prolific artist work, this experimental quality, because that also, you know, speaks to me personally about the childlike sensibility and being able to listen to those instincts. You know, and not losing that curiosity.
Yeah, and there's a bravery there as well, isn't there? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a bravery too because of the social expectation as well of what.
Oh God, yeah, can be crushing. It's as an artist, you know, you speak of myself. I'm quite aware of people's expectations of the next picture I'll make, and it's crushing in some respects, and that's why people like Bowie are so interesting, because what he was before is just binned. And then he goes on to the next one. Mm. And whether that came out of an insecurity with him or whether he was just a magpie collecting other tropes other people were experimenting with at the time and not doing quite so well, I don't know. I'm not a music historian.
No.
But I do admire that. And of course, the visual equipment is probably someone like Bowie. And it is Picasso, isn't it, the way?
Mm.
Obviously. But a lot of I can see work of mine has changed, but also I can see it sometimes I feel like a coward and I need to break away, you know, break out.
Hmm.
In fact, I think the solution, really, I have all these different ideas in my head, different avenues. I'm just going to start making work in different avenues simultaneously rather than trying to shoehorn all this my own expectations of my next piece of work into one painting.
Interesting.
Just make 10 different ones.
Yeah. Interesting. Like, you know, you speaking of that, it makes me think of just your portraiture and, you know, because with portraiture, you kind of know where it's going to go. Right. And I was wondering, like, do you think you broke away from portraiture because of that the expectation of understanding where this piece will eventually be in kind of like
the expectations. Mm-hmm. Yes, totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's monetized, of course, as well. So it's monetized right from the start. The deposit is put down and that the client has an expectation that you will render this particular daughter, wife, lover, husband, whatever, in their vision. But of course you can't, because you're not them. So on the whole, it worked okay, but there were a few times when people's expectations didn't correlate with how you sold it to them. But it is.
Yeah.
I'm not a great portrait painter, and there have been some great portrait painters out there, and their paintings have real soul and depth. And it's not something that got me out of bed in the day every morning. But I fed off the journey I had with each picture, and I could feel I was getting better at rendering certain difficult things like foreheads or whatever, or ways of the way an eye can sit to a cheek, and this complexities of this, the huge complexities. I could feel myself getting to grips with that.
Mm.
But still, I felt kind of limited. I wanted to go beyond just flesh and realities, expectations.
Mm. Hmm. Yeah, that would make sense. Yeah.
I suppose, but I think people would say some of my better work is where it's all calmed down a bit, and it is just a study of a face. And of course, the way we are all programmed as humans, two dots and a horizontal stroke is a face. And we are so drawn to this image, and it's hardwired into us, isn't it? So a well-made painting of a face is a talisman, it's a totem, it's this mesmerizing object. And even myself, when I paint a face, drawn to it, we're hypnotized by it. Even if it's actually quite a banal image, it's the most extraordinary thing. And I've always tried to subvert it somehow by covering it up. And maybe when I'm much older, I'll just be painting loads of funny old self-portraits, like late Bonnar or something, with his sort of frail face in the mirror as the boxer, which I, of course, are deeply moving. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think it's good, you know, is, you know, being open to the possibility that you don't know. And
being, of course.
Yeah, and
yeah,
constantly trying to find that curiosity. And yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting, you know, you're talking about you not being a very good portrait painter, and you won the BP Portrait Award in 1991, you know. it's very humbling in that way. And but yeah, I think there is, you know, this interestingly visceral quality. And maybe it's because, well, first of all, we all have faces. Most of us do. you know, and I mean, I think of the work of like Irving Penn, for instance, and how the way that he shot portraiture, and, you know, there's many people that have cameras, but there's only one Irving Penn. You know, and nice. It's the way that he interprets the interaction with the person, and then also the way that the aesthetic qualities of it, and you can really see the soul, you know, in his images. And I think about that, and just in the terms of great artist work in general, or at least
it's so rare, but when it's right, it's mind blowing. I remember seeing Velázquez like that, the painting of his servant. I just found just spectacular, and it has that talismanic voodoo quality about it that's just endlessly engaging. And it's how it's made, it's the empathy as we see ourselves reflected in that picture. It really makes you think how the narcissism of the human race, it is spectacular. I mean, do animals look at their reflections? I suppose maybe some higher levels do, but it is a strange thing to think about. I mean, I'm being a bit disingenuous to say, you know, I am interested in painting portraits, but I think portraits that interest me are paintings just of faces. It's when it becomes a commission, it gets more difficult for me personally.
Yeah.
But I collect many pictures of images of faces, don't we all? I mean, we've all got our postcards at home, so it's for something in it.
Yeah. Well, Justin, I just want to say, you know, thank you so much for this time, and you know, taking yesterday and
you're welcome.
Today.
Just gabbled on.
No, I mean, I love hearing you speak, you know, about your process, and you know, I think it's very fascinating, and just being able to riff with you about different subjects is fun and enlightening, and I appreciate this time.
It's been a total pleasure. Sort of focusing my own ideas a little bit through the act of talking about it, when normally one just spends their entire time in this particular space I'm talking to you, studio. I'm on my own. I don't speak to anyone, and sometimes I think I lose the power of speech. It's quite strange. So it's been a nice chance to air a few thoughts.
I think just like something that comes to mind too is just the presentness of conversation and just the presentness of being. And the more present that we are, the more that we can be observant of, you know, the things around us, or, you know, have an interesting conversation that will, you know, bring us down the rabbit hole to maybe the next piece that you create, or so I just think about that too, and being open to the possibilities that you don't currently see.
Indeed.
Yeah. Well, all right. Thanks, man. I really appreciate it. And
come on, Ashuna, you're absolutely welcome. It's been a pleasure.
It's been great. And when I'm in London next, I'll definitely have to contact you whenever I can travel.
Are you here often? I mean, were you here often back in the day?
I mean, I've been to London, but I wouldn't say often. Yeah. You know, but yeah, I'll definitely.
I've only been to LA once myself, so you've probably been to London more than that.
Yeah. I've been to London a couple times. Yeah.
Great.
So, all right, cool. Well, I guess I will talk to you later.
Yeah. All right, Yoshino. Good talking to you.
All right.
Yeah, really good. All bye right. for now.
All right, bye.
Cheers.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, a.k.a. Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. Research is by Trevor Joyce. Editing and YouTube support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in, and see you next time.